So, well, I never risked this move. I know the queen goes to f4 now, hits the knight. Then, see, the problem is that white obviously gets this pawn pair against these two, which may constitute a sort of like an advantage in space. However, it's not something that would bring immediate dividend, because still, black's position is very solid. Plus, you know, when you're attacking with your king forward, probably. So white has to spend some time now to play g3 and bishop there, and then chase this bishop out and rook out, sort of artificial castling procedure. And it's gonna cost him all the time that he gained early. So basically it's a trade-off. White probably has enough time not to fall under an attack here. But he doesn't have enough time to develop an attack of his own. Well, you know, you're right. E3 is by far the most popular move here. But you know what happens after E3? They play this, play that. They play this move. Castles. Play bishop there. You know that. This is the main position of the Moscow variation, and it's hard, you know, for white. Now, Kramnik himself on the white side, you know, he likes this kind of slow developing stuff. You know, he had it in the first round of the Mexico World Championship against Peter Svidler. Svidler, he's, you know, Russian compatriot. He never played this stuff before, he always played the Grünfeld. But, you know, this position is so solid for black. And Kramnik got nothing out of the opening, maybe it was even worse. Then for the future games, he switched to the sharp bishop h4 stuff, which was, no, maybe okay, but he didn't win those games. Drew against Gelfand and Anand. So it's a tough nut to crack, this variation. Well, you play e4, looks so natural, but he takes, knight takes, queen back to e7. You see some pressure developing here. And black is actually, you know, looks kind of comfortable there with the fianchetted bishop, right? Bishop puts pressure here and he's sitting there thinking, oh, c5 to open the diagonal. Black might actually get a better game. If he liberates this bishop, either, no, usually via b6, bishop b7 followed by c5, he will just get a better game. Because of the bishop pair. What is white doing? Where is white's attack? Bishop on d3. Now it just bites this granite, you know, then g6. It's not your usual stuff where you, you know, you get this type of space advantage and then you build up. If knight e5 and f4, you can't play knight e5. He'll take twice. So that's why, you know, the system, it proved to be very resilient. Okay. So on the white side of this, I've been struggling with you know, this Moscow variation for many years. And I tried different things here. Well, one idea that always intrigued me was to try to play e4 in one go, but maybe not right away. And I experimented with the queen c2 move. So after e4, I would take with the queen then. And then supported with bishop d3. Well, you know, like knight d7, for example, e4, queen takes. And maybe hoping for bishop e7, bishop d3, and now black castles. And then I win the game. Well, truth to tell, while this position was on the board in some of my games, none of my opponents castled short in this situation. So I'm still waiting for this to happen. But I mean, time's running short on me. So I don't know. Well, maybe you should try. Yeah, there are some implications of the Quincy too. Although I did win some games and another move I played a long time ago is this. A very, very modest move, but the idea is to push e4 quicker. Now you say, what's the difference? You play e3, then e4, you lose a tempo here, you lose a tempo on this, and you play this in one go. Well, the difference is that I try to get this stuff quicker. So if you take, I take, and if you say you go back to e7, so you want to do the same setup, right? Now I will play this move right away. Very good. So I save time on this bishop there and castles. So in order to interfere with his play. So this you may say, I mean, it's in a nutshell, you know, obviously there are more you know, details here to discuss, but this is basically what it is about. All right? Did I invent the A3 move? I don't think so. Although I played it, you know, fairly early in the 1980s, but I think before me Kasparov played it. And he had a game which quickly turned him off this line. And he never played it again. He only played it once. His opponent, experienced grandmaster Sveshnikov, known for his variation in the Sicilian, the Sveshnikov Sicilian, right? Took. Gary played this move. It's precisely what happened in the game. And counting on b5, which has been played later, and actually before that and later, I had some games. White gets some typical compensation. White plays like a Catalan type of stuff. Now the bishop goes there, sets up, knight takes b5. Because this pawn is going to be pinned, the bishop. And, it forces black into defensive. White gets compensation. But Sveshnikov didn't allow this to happen. Played a very surprising move, c5. That took Kasparov by surprise, and the idea is clear. He wants to undermine this knight. It seems like, you know, how can black do this? He's behind on development. Isn't he going to fall, you know, victim to some queen check, you know, some diagonal problems? Yeah.
Yeah, didn't we miss a move? Grandmaster Yermolinsky didn't... looks like, yeah, the white didn't get a move there.
White did play this little move.
Oh, white played the a3. Okay,
yeah.
My mistake.
I takes, all right, knight e5. And now the best move is c5. Okay. Well, there are different, there's check, there is e3, but there is knight b5, there are different attempts. But to be honest, you know, white doesn't have any advantage in any of them. So why did I play this? No, well, it's a bluff of sorts. Well, while to me, you know, that 1981 and the Kasparov-Sveshnikov game was like yesterday. And Vinay, well, you know, he wasn't born yet. So this is what you do. You know, you try it. No, obviously, well, there was a fair chance. I was going to play e3 and try my luck with the isolated pawn. Unfortunately, with the isolated pawn setups, usually white has to build up slower. And here the knight on e5 can be just black and just develop his knight and offer this exchange. And it's more difficult for white to keep pieces on the board. Unfortunately, I've already exchanged one potential attacker, but there is still a little bit. You know, that's...
You can take with the queen, right?
Yeah, I could, but then it gets kind of... So you play this
Queen
knight.
Queen xd, and then knight f...
Knight
d7. Knight f3, right? Queen,
yeah,
queen
but,
knight...
Yeah, but where's my advantage, you know, so... I mean, get the queens off, you know, so I can't attack, you know, has the bishops. No, anyway. Now, he plays this move. That's a sign of relief. Now I do believe that white has a good position here. All the